So, well, welcome to the seminar, and thank you very much for participating in this event. And I think this will be an interesting session to discuss both health and education in the context of the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. And we have distinguished scholars from both from Japan and the US, and will be introduced later. But first, I'd like to briefly explain why we have this meeting, and then we're going to start the presentations. Our presentation will be short, like maybe 10 minutes, less than 10 minutes, so that would leave plenty of time for discussion. And we have distinguished commentators, and so we're going to kick off this seminar. Okay, so the title of this seminar is Achieving the Health and Education Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, Exploring US-Japan Partnerships for Human Development. And I'm going to explain the background. Basically, we are at the critical juncture. There are basically 17 SDGs to be achieved by 2030, both domestically and internationally. These are universal goals. And for the US and Japan, investing in human development, health and education SDGs makes sense in an era of globalization. So we are doing this not just for the humanity, for the sake of humanity, but also for our national interests. And there will be opportunities for the US and Japan to collaborate towards the 2019 G20 Osaka Summit that was just announced last week officially by the Secretary of the State. And we still haven't had the fixed dates for the G20 summit, but it will be the first G20 summit to be hosted by Japan. Of course, G7 comes every 7 years, but G20 comes every 20 years, so this is our first time to hold it. So I'm pretty sure that you are familiar with the SDGs, and I'm not going through the 17 goals, but we are going to look at the goal 3 and the goal 4. And also, we are going to look at number 10, which is to reduce inequalities, both in the country and internationally, and also 17 partnerships for the goals. We are not going through this, but basically health, education, and reduce inequality within and among countries, and strengthening the partnership. Principles of the SDGs, they are universal in a sense that they apply for both developing countries and developed countries, which is a bit different from the MDGs. The Millennium Development Goals want to be promoted for developing countries, and developed countries are supposed to help developing countries achieve the MDGs, but SDGs are for all the member states, for the United Nations. And the goals are interconnected, so and we are forced to break down the silos. So we have education experts, health experts, but at least for human development, we have to work together because they are interconnected. Also, inclusive implementation, leaving no one behind, and Dr. Akashi will talk a bit about how to promote health for refugees and migrants. And we need to take integrated action rather than fragmented actions. And partnership through multi-stakeholder collaboration. So we're talking about not just the states, but civil society organizations and private sector. And public-private partnership is very important, both for health and education. Investing in human development for the US and Japan, and health security from public health threats and cross-border health threats are really imminent. And also non-communicable diseases in high and middle-income countries, and for risk factors, tobacco, harmful use of alcohol, unhealthy diet, and physical inactivity. So I think we are not just talking about the medical response to these threats, but also we need education to bring about behavioral change, and giving patients ownership of their health data for empowerment, and health education for behavioral change. Is very important, and Dr. Kashi again will talk about it. Also, inclusive education, respecting diversity, I think Professor Broda will talk about that. So, what are the opportunities ahead of us for the US and Japan to collaborate? In 2018, this year, so in September, I think pretty much we are not talking about events, but Professor Kuroda will complement my presentation with all the education milestone events. But we're going to have a high-level meeting on tuberculosis and a high-level meeting on non-communicable diseases this September at the UN. And in October, we are going to celebrate the 40th anniversary conference of the ALMATA, Declaration of Primary Healthcare. In 2019, we're going to host Japan, of course, the G20 Osaka Summit with health ministers meeting. So this is a kind of a new tradition, and I'd like to ring a bell for this particular aspect of the G20, because for the first time at the G20, Germany decided to hold a health ministers meeting when the G20 was held in Hamburg. And Argentina is coming in a few months. They're going to also organize health ministers meeting. So this is a kind of a new tradition created by Germany, and Japan is likely to continue this exercise. So in addition to the UN General Assembly, WHO World Health Assembly, and G7, and now we have G20 to be used for the health, global health discussion. In the summer, and the dates to be determined later, but 7th Tokyo International Conference on African Development, TICAD, will be held in Yokohama, and this is an opportunity for Japan to engage in dialogues with the African countries on health and education and other things, of course. And in September, a high-level meeting on universal health coverage to be held in New York. So I think there are a number of events where we can work together between the two countries. So that's the kind of background for this seminar. And if I may continue my presentation, I'd like to move on to the next topic, which is basically about health security. Okay, so looking at the Sustainable Development Goals, number three, I have to see how I'm doing. And good health and well-being, but let me focus on health security, and Dr. Akashi will talk more about the refugees and the migrants. So, we probably do not need to review what the SDGs number three talk about, infectious disease control and health security from public health threats. So, they are more well-defined in the SDGs, that I think that we made advancement from the Millennium Development Goals. And more specifically, Ebola outbreak in Africa gave us a kind of wake-up call to see that we need to improve our global health landscape with the governments. And that has been a topic in the last few years, as Professor Boston knows it very well. He was personally involved in many of them. Policy-making process. The question for me was that why did the 2014 Ebola virus disease outbreak claim so many lives in West Africa? And to explore this issue, I interviewed staff members at the United Nations Secretariat, as well as funding programs and World Health Organizations between 2015 and 2016. And I also interviewed survivors, health workers, and medical professionals, government officials, staff members of non-NGOs, and UN agencies in Conakry, the capital city of Guinea in April and May 2016. And I have someone who accompanied me to Guinea, Ms. Inde, who now works at the World Bank. And we had an interesting interviews. And the two research questions for me while visiting many stakeholders in Guinea. Why couldn't the WHO declare public health emergency of international concern sooner? And what forced the United Nations Secretary General to establish the UN mission for Ebola emergency response, AMIA? So these were the two research questions I had interviewing people in New York, Washington DC, London, and also Geneva and Guinea. And after answering these questions, I'm trying to come up with some recommendations. So this is kind of a historical fact, so I probably do not need to go through this, but as we know that the response, international response to the Ebola outbreaks in West Africa was very slow. And also, at the same time, while the governments and international organizations were slow to respond, NGOs such as MSF were shouting at the international community that something has to be done, but no response coming from, particularly from the WHO. And I think, okay, so I move to the conclusions. So why not fake SUNA and their conclusions? Reason one, Guinean government, as this was the first Ebola outbreak in West Africa, the government did not have sufficient experiences, and Ebola outbreaks were there in Africa, but the first time in Guinea at this scale. The government was optimistic, believing that even if an outbreak occurred in the southeastern forest region of Guinea, it would not affect Macri, the capital. So they were quite optimistic that to be contained in the forest region, surrounded by not just by Guinea, but also Sierra Leone and Liberia. From the fear of the fake declaration triggering economic damage, the government did not proactively disclose information. So they were very concerned about the economic impact of fake being declared. The reason number two has a lot to do with the WHO. The second reason is related to WHO. It was originally anticipated that the WHO regional office in Africa, AFRO, would take the lead for further assistance. However, due to its limited human resources and funding, AFRO was unable to fulfill its role successfully. The WHO intergovernmental body with the head office in Geneva declared a grade 3 emergency within the organization itself, but the fake declaration was not made public until August to add consideration of the intent of the government, such as India. So being an international organization, I think they listened more carefully to the government rather than to the civil society organizations. So that delayed their response. Why AMI? So I go to the conclusions. So reason one, as the limitation of the WHO's capability to lead and coordinate field activities became apparent, the UN needed to demonstrate strong leadership both internally and externally. And of course, the pressure coming from the US was quite influential. It was unprecedented for the UN Secretary General to take a lead in the fight against the infectious disease, which could normally be assigned to the WHO. So AMIA creation was quite unprecedented. Although temporarily, the WHO showed hesitance because it appeared that AMIA would be structured above the WHO, an autonomous specialized agency in the UN Army. This caused tension between the UN Secretary General and WHO Director General, who could not generally be a superior subordinate relationship because WHO is a special agency with a special agency agreement with the United Nations Secretariat. So there is no direct relationship. Reason number two, proposal for OCHA to take action utilizing the Central Emergency Response Fund was made, but this did not come to reality. Humanitarian crisis due to natural disaster and armed conflicts were increasing, and it was decided that OCHA neither had experience, framework, nor funding to undertake this new type of humanitarian crisis triggered by an epidemic. Reason number three, a large amount of funds needed to be mobilized without a moment's delay. The quickest way is to do this was to create a new UN mission, seeking authorization from the General Assembly and the Security Council. So AMIA was the way to go for the UN as a last result. Okay, based on those assessment, analysis, recommendations come for first, for international health regulations, an informal enforcement mechanism to help the country implement the international health regulation will be necessary. Positive incentives for the country to comply with the reporting obligations, because not many countries are willing to do it. and strengthen the monitoring of and support to the countries to develop the minimum core public health capabilities to implement IHR to the global health security agenda, etc., would be necessary. Number two, about the fake page to be graded, that's because it's black or white, and it's very difficult to degrade. Independent risk assessment mechanism should be necessary, should be created, receiving not only from the governments, but also from non-state actors. So it's a little bit political to declare. And of course, Director General of the WHO is in a position to do it, but it should be based on kind of a neutral assessment by experts, but not that way currently. The WHO Director General informed by the independent risk assessment mechanism will be responsible, finally, to declare. Finance. This part has been quite, I think we have witnessed advancement in this area. Finance. Now we have WHO's contingency fund for emergency and the World Bank as pandemic emergency facility. So this newly created fund should be supported by the finance. So these are pretty much for the preparedness. Coordination between the WHO and the UN system, which is always difficult. Situation-based coordination mechanism should be planned ahead with MOU in case of when coordination between health and other sectors or clusters required. At the early stage of emerging health issues advised by the WHO, the UN country teams should be allowed to use their resources for response in consultation with the government. And in response to outbreaks, the OCHA should be committed for cluster coordination when the country governments this coordination mechanism. As soon as the transition of UN leadership at the country level from resident coordinator to the humanitarian coordinator should be secured, which is a little bit difficult for human factors. People do not want to move sometimes to be removed from the position. So these are the recommendations. So I think I'll stop here, but for the recommendation for the G20, I think we have made much progress in the financing part, but building core capacities for the international health regulations is still a slow process. But I think the G20 member states are the combination of the traditional donors, like the G7, and emerging donors, represented by BRICS. So they have the capacity to do it, but I think the only thing is that they have to make commitment to do so. So G20 can be a good forum to make a commitment to build the core capacities of international health regulations. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention, and I'll give the microphone to Dr. Takashi. So please hold your comments and questions until we finish the health presentation and the comments made by Professor Tosaka.
My name is Akashi. I'm from Japan National Center for Global Health and Medicine. This is under the research chairman. And this time I would like to focus on the refugees and migrants. And the leaving no one behind, this is one of the kind of slogan of SDGs. And in the health, in goal number three, universal health coverage has been highlighted in SDGs, especially the target 3.8. And however, the concept of the universal tends to be focused on the citizens of the country. So how about the people who left or went out and their countries like refugees? And maybe already you know the US mentioned on December 3rd last year, the US government announced that they will withdraw from the so-called New York Declaration for refugees and migrants, which is the fundamentals of However, whether the U.S. government withdraw or not, we have considered today how the international community should best respond to the growing global phenomenon of large movements of the refugees and migrants. And especially we are focusing on the health of refugees. Recently, some articles mentioned about the refugees' health. And then, for instance, in Lancet last year, refugee health is a public health crisis of this century, and the stronger collaboration of the global community is needed. And also this is the article in Who Has Responsibility for Refugee Health. And also another Lancet said the refugees toward better access to healthcare services. In that article, despite this high burden of disease, access to healthcare for refugees is mostly restricted in host countries. So, but how we have to overcome such a difficulty? So, I remember the Japanese way. Can we use what the Unshin handbook? Maybe some Japanese already know the MCH handbook. We call it in Japanese Boshi Kenko Techo. This is my son. He was born in New York 2007, and then he moved back to Japan. And growing up, but he used this MCH handbook, which I got in Japan, and brought to Japan, US, and I asked the doctors in US, and then he wrote down the records on the book record, handbook. And then it contained the record of the points of the immunization or the growth level or something like that. So therefore, even he went back to Japan, the Japanese doctor can refer the records. So what is the system? The MCH service provision system in Japan, through MCH handbook, that is when the lady thought, I'm pregnant, she went to a hospital or clinic, and then doctors confirmed the pregnancy. After that, the lady will go to the municipal government, and then the pregnant registration is done, and then simultaneously she can get the MCH handbook. It contains some points of the free ANC antenatal care vouchers or other things. After that, she go to the clinic or hospital for ANC, and also sometimes the local government provide a mother's class or health advices. And then, after the delivery, childbirth, she also can get the birth certificate at the clinic or hospital. And then, she go to the local government, and then the birth registration happened. After that, the local government provide other services such as immunization vouchers or growth monitoring vouchers, and they can go to the she can go to the she and baby, her baby go to the clinics, and then they can get the services. So, in this system, there are three main actors. One is the service users, like a mother or a baby. And the second is the health professionals, like a doctor or midwife. And third is the local government. So through this process, each actor can get the benefits. Therefore, three actors want to participate in this service system. So, what is the feature, main features of this system through MCH handbook and pregnancy registration? The first one is users can keep or and access to their own health data and information that lead to the ownership. And the second one, the users can bring their own health data and information with them, the portable. And the third one is that the medical doctors can refer to the previous data and the information of users. So therefore, they can refer to previous data by different doctors. That means even that the pregnant women change their clinics or hospitals, each different doctors can refer the same information. The fourth one, the local governments can grasp the pregnant women and their babies. So the local government can know the who is where. So the fifth one is the local government can provide social support to the users. That means not only the medical services, but also the social support points at through public health nurse or other mechanism we can provide the social support. So this is the countries that introduce or plan to introduce MCG handbook, around 40 countries, including in US, the Utah. I thought that they already introduced. And for the refugees, for the points of the Palestinian refugees in Jordan, UNRWA, that is the UN agency for Palestinian refugees. But they already introduced a paper-based MCH handbook. And then last year, they started the smartphone-based e-MCH handbook. So, if refugees have refugee health handbook, maybe they can keep their own records with them from place to place, like MCH handbook. Even they come across the border of the country, so they can receive the appropriate health care, something like that. And then again, in this system, we can expect the three actors. One is the users, like a refugee. So the same thing happens, ownership. So person-centered system, and also the portable. So as I said, even they cross the border, they can bring information. And also the user can get the vouchers if each country provides such a services through voucher. Also for the medical professional, the same thing, the referable to the present, the previous data. So it can reduce the duplication or discontinuation of the health interventions, such as vaccination or tuberculosis treatment. And also that they can know the occurrence of the infectious diseases And local government also, they can grasp the users. So maybe they can use the data to prevent the outbreaks. And also that they can provide the social services. Now we are in the process to develop refugee health handbook and its electronic version in Jordan. We would like to know your tips for inclusive UHC. Thank you very much for that.
I would like to welcome Professor Costin to give us some comments and feedback.
Well, thank you very much for your presentation. They were both really excellent. And the one focusing mostly on governance for health and for development, and the other on the other value of ESGs, which is really no one behind. And I think it's quite clear that the refugee population around the world are one of the most vulnerable. And they're all, these are also interrelated, as was mentioned, because they can bring infectious disease and cause outbreaks when they're not getting the kinds of services they need, and they're crossing international boundaries. The refugee issue also is particularly interesting in that it has very poor governance, although there are or are excellent agencies like the UN High Commissioner for Refugees. The international protection for particularly internal migration and other migrant populations is particularly weak and not very enforceable. So there are parallels to governance for health and governance for refugees and also interrelationships between the two. What I want to do, and I'm glad my friends from the Institute of Medicine, National Academy of Medicine are here, because many of these accounts were derived from the commission report that the National Academy of Medicine led post Ebola, and CC was the director of that project, did a fantastic job. So I hope I can do justice. It seems to me that although global security is very complicated, that ultimately there are three foundational building blocks for global health security. And they match very much with the SDGs and also with our two presentations here. I'll mention the three and then I'll just talk a very brief amount of time on each of the three. But the first one is literally the foundation, which is universal health coverage for strong health systems. The second one is to have strong international organizations and international organizations that are responsive and well governed. And as well as having governments well governed. And then the third area is research and development, to actually be able to develop the kinds of vaccines and pharmaceuticals that we need to combat outbreaks and epidemics and pandemics. And in that bucket, I would include antimicrobial resistance and to try to find remedies, policy remedies for reducing antimicrobial resistance, because we have to remember with AMR, we're not going to be able to defeat it solely by continually making more and more antimicrobial medications of higher value than actual policies, both for prescribing and also in animal communities and farming. So those are the three areas that I want to discuss. First is universal health coverage. Universal health coverage is, as you know, one of the leading targets of the Sustainable Development Goals. The United Nations is holding a high-level session on it. So it is becoming of transformational value. So how does universal health coverage meld with two other major global initiatives? One is the 40th anniversary of Alma Mater. So that's really focusing on primary health care. Now, primary health care is a part of universal health coverage, but only a part, a very important part. And then secondly are the core capacities in the international health regulation. So you've got these three cross-cutting but almost siloed ideas of the international health regulations, which is a global health treaty focused on maintaining those core capacities. You have universal health coverage, which is a World Health Organization initiative, and in the Sustainable Development Goals, the key targets in Goal 3. And then you have primary care and the continuing battle to actually make Alma Mater a reality, which it never has been. So clearly, I think universal health coverage is the overall umbrella and the most important part of building these kinds of robust health systems that can help global health security. It's exceedingly important, but even universal health coverage is much confused. Nobody really knows exactly what it is. If you look at WHO, it has a definition that includes promoted services, which are public health services. If you look at the SDGs, it's clear that population-based public health isn't even covered. It's all about medical care and health care. Whereas for clearly in an infectious disease outbreak, you need strong public health measures, things like not just health care, but surveillance, laboratory capacities, reporting and notifications. You also need good public health laws for when you might need social separation or hand hygiene or potentially even isolation quarantines. But they all have to be evidence-based and well-practiced, which did not happen in Ebola, in places like Liberia. The quarantines were far from evidence-based, and in fact against WHO recommendations. So I think we need to have these strong health systems at the bottom, because unless every country has a decent health system, we're going to have outbreaks and then we'll get out of control. And so in order to be able to identify, report, and respond to an outbreak, there's nothing more important than the local and national abilities to do that. And I think it's incumbent upon WHO, the United Nations, and International Development for Health to actually support low and middle income countries to do that. So that's the first, that I'm going to be suggesting some governance problems and governance solutions to that problem of when I talk about this next area, which is global governance for health. I tend not to use the word global health governance, because it's not just governing the health sector, it's governing across sectors, because anything that really is effective in health has to deploy multiple sectors. I mean, just to give the most obvious example would be departments of agriculture, departments of food, to mention ministries of finance. So one of the major focuses of the international health regulations is the obligation of all member states, or basically all states parties to that treaty, to develop what the IHR calls health, core health system capacities. These are the kinds of things I've talked about before. They're the ability to prepare, to respond, laboratories, good public health laws, surveillance systems, things like that that are critically important. And yet, most countries around the world, although they have a legal obligation to develop these systems, have not done so. And one of the big problems before and after Ebola was the fact that there was no evaluation system that was objective and rigorous and transparent to let the world know which countries had developed these capacities, which hadn't, and for those that hadn't, what were the pathways and funding needs that would be needed to get them there. This was an enormous problem. WHO basically gave a pass to countries. They were supposed to, under the IHR, develop these core capacities by a certain date. They literally allowed all those who asked for it to have an extension. And then it was all self-reported. Well, the National Academy of Medicine's report, the UN Secretary General's Ebola report, and the Harvard London School of Hygiene report, all three recommended a system of joint or objective evaluation. And the objective evaluation could have been modeled on the more rigorous matrices of the Global Health Security Agenda. The problem with the Global Health Security Agenda was that, frankly, it was US, thought to be US-led, and so it didn't have the legitimacy of the World Health Organization. So WHO did something which I think is quite smart. They've since developed, using Global Health Security Agenda matrices, or modeled on them, what's called a joint external evaluation. The joint external evaluation is an evaluation that takes place jointly between domestic experts and international experts. It's fully transparent so that the grading and the problems within it are supposed to be open to view. The big problem, of course, is that it's voluntary. And the other big problem is that there are few funds to actually help countries to achieve what they need to do. Although Jim Kim and the World Bank and with its pandemic financing is interested in trying to help in this regard. The government of Japan has made some serious commitments, both fiscally and politically at the G7, thanks to you. So there's a lot going on. And one of the pieces of good news is that there are more and more countries signing up for the what's called the JEE. But there's another problem. The problem is that in order to maintain domestic preparedness and global preparedness, you need preparedness both for human and for zoonotic pathogens. And the World Organization for Animal Health has its own quite good, quite rigorous evaluations machinery. And so what we need is to have all countries go through both processes, the WHO process and the animal process. And yet, less than a dozen countries have done so. And so that's going to be a big problem going forward. The other governance problem with the international health regulations, of course, was one that we just heard about, which is when to declare a public health emergency of international concern. I was very interested in your research because your research suggested that the reason that a FIC wasn't declared earlier was because of deference to West African countries. That's not in the international health regulations. That kind of deference to the country is not there. That's not one of the criteria. So they were wrong to do that, and hopefully they've learned that lesson going forward. And of course, with Zika, it was much more prompt than it was with Ebola. But also under the IHR, in public health emergencies of international concern, WHO Director General makes recommendations. And it tends to make those recommendations around public health measures, including avoiding travel and trade restrictions and unnecessary quarantines that are not based upon science. WHO has made these recommendations, and about the only thing you can say about what's happened as a result of these recommendations is that countries have done the opposite. Because one of the things, I'm writing a book now for Harvard University Press on global health security, and kind of the theme of the book is that we tend to lurch between panic and complacency. So during the point of an epidemic, like Ebola, we panic, we overreact, we become irrational. And then, as soon as we're in interpandemic periods, as we are now, we become complacent. And then it's a circular thing. You can see that happening here in the United States, for example. And then the third area, and I'll just be much more brief on this, is research and development. There are many, again, very positive things to report since Ebola. One of them is the role that WHO's taken in looking at priority research needs. Another is the new public-private partnership, CEPI, that's trying to create economic and other leverage to get research platforms for important pharmaceutical and vaccine development going forward. And of course, you have the Gavi Alliance that tries to get vaccines involved. But nonetheless, I think we need to have a considerably more public-private partnership and investment in high-priority pandemic-prone viruses. It's critically important because if you look at the economic incentives that pharmaceutical companies have, it's not for pandemic vaccinations. In fact, the perfect economic model for a pharmaceutical company is a predictable market, one that's highly saturated, and giving you a tablet that doesn't cure the disease. So something like blood pressure medication, statins, things like that where rich countries take them for long periods of time, it's a high prevalence rate, and you keep having to take them. Pandemics are too episodic. They're not, the markets aren't predictable enough, and so you do need new innovative incentives. You do need public-private partnerships. National Academy of Medicine recommended what I've since called a peace dividend or a health dividend, a small annual incremental investment into research and development, which I think would be a very, very smart move. The Institute also recommended this kind of a net incremental increase for core capacities as well. So with that, I know I've run over my time. Two great presentations. It's a very, very great honor to be here and commenting on them.
Thank you very much. Overview of the issue we talked about, and I'd like to put the microphone to Professor Kuza to move on to the discussion on education. Yes.
Thank you very much for coming to these sessions. Being different from the previous presentations and discussion comments, I'd like to talk about the education and global governance, and then also to prospect US-Japan partnership, what Japan can offer for the partnership. The possible areas of US-Japan partnership, and if we focus on what can came from Auckland. Then I think I would actually, I used to have actually the unfinished agenda of the disability education, but I didn't, I decided not to present about this here. But the two topics on the continued agenda of the quality of education, and then also new agenda, values and contents of education that we would like to discuss now within this time. First, the continued agenda from the MDGs to SDGs is the quality of education. As in the process of the MDGs, we found that the significant quality gap exists in the world. SACMEC, that's actually a regional assessment test in South or East Africa, found that, for example, Tanzania is a very performing well, but like Zambia and Malawi, in which actually the students, at their grade six, it means actually they have already completed 5 years of education. 30 or 40 actually percent of these grade six students cannot read or write. So there is a big significance actually quality gap exists in Africa and in the world. And also, development economics started to find that the quality of education matters for economic growth rather than the quantity of education. So quality of education is important for the social progress. And that's why the SDGs emphasize the quality and then also learning outcomes and then literacy numeracy repeatedly in the goal four. So what Japan can offer? Japan lost completely, I think, confidence in its economic policy for the last 25 years. But still, Japan has a high pride and also of the education outcomes. As you can find in the PISA 2015, that's a US PISA results, Japan scored the highest, actually, among the OECD member countries in math and science, because some of the Asian countries are not a member of the OECD. And then also in the even readings, Japanese students performs very well. So that's why the Japanese government, Ministry of Education, is leading actually a new initiative called EduPort Japan, that is a public private nationwide initiative to proactively disseminate Japanese style education overseas. So that's one possibility of the collaborations. And then second possibility of the collaborations is existing in the new agenda of the SDGs, which is values and contents of education. Because MDGs didn't have any discussions of the purpose or values or contents of education, but the SDGs does. I think this is the distinct features of the SDGs, which is included as a 4.7, SDGs 4.7, that emphasizes the importance of the values of education, like education for sustainable development and sustainable lifetimes, human rights, gender equality, promotion of the culture of peace and nonviolence, global citizenship, and appreciation of cultural diversity. It's very difficult to measure and also promote this kind of values of education in the as a global governance framework. But now the global society has committed actually to do this with the SDGs. What Japan can offer? The ESP, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with this, but the Education for Sustainable Development was the concept Japan proposed to the international society at the Johannesburg Summit in 2002, and then that was taken by UNESCO, and then it made as a UN decade of Education for Sustainable Development from 2005 to 2014. So the concluding conference was held in Nagoya in Japan, and then Japan is still committed to this ESD, and then also make ESD as a core part of the Japanese national curriculum. So we have a certain advantage of the promoting this ESD in the educational policy in the global governance also. And then also in the international community, society, the 21st century skills is also now is growingly started to be more regarded as an important part of the directions of the educational policies and the international society. And also again, according to the latest PISA scores, they scored for the first time, actually scored the collaborative problem solving skills, and then Japan performed very, very well, also again, actually, in this test. So that's the area maybe we can offer something and for the future of the global governance of education, and then also US-Japan partnership. In the end, I'd like to also mention and then also highlight the long-term, study of the impact of the study abroad. In the context of this SDGs goal 4.7, we did the surveys for the Japanese who has study abroad experience, 4,500 of them, and then also as a control group, we also surveyed 1,300 Japanese without study abroad experience, and then made the comparisons of the these two sets of the groups. And we found that in terms of awareness of being Asian or globalism, or awareness of peace, awareness of the greater religious trends, gender equality or sustainabilities, all these are kind of values identified, included in the SDGs goal 4.7, are very much promoted by the study abroad experience if we compare the with and without populations. Also, for the 21st century skills like flexibility, social skills, non-cognitive skills, problem solving skills, communication skills, creativity, critical thinking skills, these kind of 21st century skills is also found to be very much promoted by the study abroad experience. So study abroad is also one means actually to promote the 4.7 goals of the SDGs. But if we look at the current situations or recent moves in Asia in terms of the policy frameworks of the student mobility, in Asia, we have emerging actually multi-layered structures of the promoting student mobility in the Asian countries, in ASEAN, ASEAN plus 3, even like Northeast Asian countries like China, Korea, Japan also has started this Campus Asia for promoting the student mobility in the regions. However, within the United States and Asia, we don't have such frameworks. Of course, we have a significant number of the student mobility between the two regions in the North America, between the North America and Japan Asia. But and then if you look at, for example, this is actually also I conducted with the JICA Research Institute, the surveys for the leading universities in Northeast Asian regions, identified that the most collaborative, most active cross-border activities partner regions for Northeast Asian countries, leading universities, are North America, in the past, present, and future. But we know also that the decreasing number of the Japanese students in North America, and so on. So we should really establish the new framework to promote the student mobility to tackle in the North American and Asian countries to tackle on to achieve the SDGs goal 4.7. So these two agenda on the continuing agenda on the curriculum education and new agenda for the goal 4.7, we may be able to collaborate between the US and Japan. That's my message. Thank you very much.
don't have a PowerPoint. Forgive me.
Can you hear me?
Yes. How long do I have?
Ten
minutes, okay. Please signal when I go over that. It's a danger. Occupational hazard. A real one. Stepping back, thank you all for the wonderful presentations. It's always interesting to hear from cousin fields of endeavor. Health, education and health are closely related, but perhaps not quite brother and sister, perhaps coming from different parents, but the same impulses of human development. So thank you very much for that, and thank you, Professor Quiloda, for your wonderful presentation. Stepping back a little bit, isn't it, thinking about the Sustainable Development Goals, isn't it actually a fairly amazing thing to have these goals? Even achieving them, of course, is important, and we haven't done it yet, but just thinking, say, 100 years ago, 100 years ago, Europe was involved in a war, countries fighting each other, of course, and wars have not stopped. But the idea that we would be working together as a collective humanity to move toward these kinds of goals is really quite remarkable. And so I would ask us to not to be Pollyanna-ish about it, but to recognize some of the aspirations that we've been able to at least put into to words. The assumptions, ambitions of the Sustainable Development Goals, they're universal, so no longer are we thinking about solely about developing and developed countries. We're thinking about humanity, thinking the human development as a whole. They are, they're universal. They are, let's see, I've got notes here, sorry, too many notes. Holistic, so we're thinking about the ways the different Sustainable Development Goals work together to support, of course, with, what is it, 147?
169. Targets.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have a huge number of targets, goals, that we're striving for, and then we get into indicators. But with all those things, recognize we burrow into our own sectors, but we also recognize increasingly the ways in which work in one requires involves work in others. The fact that we have to collaborate to work together to achieve them. All of that's really quite remarkable. And thinking back 100 years, millions of children, and I should have looked it up, but millions of children have not died because of advances in medicine, of course. And it's actually just remarkable how many children have not died because of advances in medicine. Millions of people are literate now, can read and write and participate more actively in the collective culture that we have. And that's actually remarkable compared to a period of time ago. Millions of people are not at desperately poor as before. Countries, I mean, I'm fairly old, but I remember even in university, countries that were described as basket cases would never move beyond subsistence and a very level of income are now doing quite well, can feed themselves, can feed others. It's remarkable the amount of progress we've made. So this is great. All of this is good stuff. Many places to go. But it's important to recognize that our education as a species has kind of made some progress. There are a lot of forces that would have us not move in those directions. But I would argue that the more we can emphasize the advancement of human development as a whole, the better off we will all be. But of course, you can tell where that's going. Education and health are both enormously important. Of course, I began my professional career thinking about the ways that education and health could work more collaboratively within US government development programming so as to support the goals of both, and that school-based health and that sort of thing was quite interesting. health has a lot to teach education. I'm an educator, so I come at it from that perspective. Health has a lot to teach education. You've been enormously successful in mobilizing funds. We're jealous of you for that. You've been enormously successful in identifying outcomes and getting much more precise in measuring and tracking what it is you're trying to do. And so the discussions of the need for rigorous evaluation, absolutely, and education much more so. Very good about that. Education is nice. Education is important because, of course, in its own right, it's important for people to be able to read, write, and do those various things. But education also enables the other SDGs in a very particular way. Education allows humanity, in some sense, to reflect on itself and its experience, and in a sense, maybe to get better. And so the famous quote by MacLeish in the Charter of UNESCO, we like to cite, since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed. Inspiring, idealistic, perhaps unrealistic, but also true in so many, in a deep, profound sort of way. And so thinking about how education can promote the important skills of reading and writing, mathematics and science, but also the important content of those areas, but also thinking about how education can promote these other things, learning to live together, social emotional learning, 20th century skills, education for sustainable development, education for global citizenship, all of those things is really quite critical. Seems to me education has gone through 3 to 5 phases. And we're not finished with any of them, but we've made good progress. Access, the first point, getting people into school one way or another. Relative success, but not perfect in doing that. We never really achieved the Millennium Development Goals. And then we said, okay, let's make them bigger. And maybe that's a good idea. I remember once, and I was working in a country where the qualifications for teachers was a bachelor's degree. No, was a high school certificate, actually, for teachers, had to have a high school degree. And they only 40% at that point had achieved that credential. And the ministry said, let's raise it. Let's make the requirement a bachelor's degree for everyone. And on the face of it, it seems the wrong direction. Why not achieve your smaller target before your bigger one? But in the mobilization of human imagination, maybe a big target is good. Maybe. So access, getting kids in school, getting people in school. Some success with that, and then so we start thinking, well, who's not in school? And we start moving, as health is, toward thinking about refugees or children with disabilities or that kind of thing. And when we start thinking about that, then we start thinking, what we're talking about people, children with disabilities, but let's turn the focus away from the deficits of individuals and groups to the systemic capacity to include everyone. So we move toward inclusion. Okay, like health. Quality, you know, it's for years and years, for at least 40 years, people have been talking about the poor quality. We've got access, we need to return to quality. Yes. Recently, with some success in improving quality, I guess, we have now turned to learning and what are children learning? That's good, it's better. It's astonishing what many children in many places are not learning, very basic sorts of things. But then we think about the non-cognitive kinds of learning that we want children. So Japan has taken the lead in promoting education for sustainable development, and that's a wonderful thing. So I'm not sure what the point of all this is. I think the point is to highlight the noble intentions and the need to keep pushing those assumptions, the assumptions that collectively we can deal with many of these issues, and the importance of collaboration across countries in doing that. So the Japan-U.S. relationship, obviously many things we can do. I think continuing to support collaborative activities, even if we don't call it that. The U.S. withdrew from the, in December, the important convention that I don't remember, but it's one of a number of things we've withdrawn from. Nonetheless, we can continue to, I mean, we can push against that, but we can also continue to work collaboratively to subvert those withdrawals. We can provide experience. Japan's experience in education and in health is quite remarkable, and it can share that. It tends to be humble, and maybe should share more of its experience with other countries. Provide financial and technical support, and can send people to other places and receive people from other places as students and as immigrants and as migrants, so as to better understand each other and better support ourselves in our human progress, as opposed to simply putting our national progress in the context of the larger global efforts. So, a few thoughts.
I'm sorry about my time management, and I think we probably need to open the floor for comments and questions, and feel free to raise your hands and make comments, questions. Yes.
Well, I really agree with Mr. Williams. We got to be really positive about this, and we have justification. I have a website, peoplenow.org. I don't want to take too much time, but the main thing I say is this is the most important initiative of all time, by far. It covers everything. And we've got people working on them. And what he says about collaboration is really important, getting them working together. But I invite anybody to look at that website, peoplenow.org. I was a Nuke Submariner in the Navy. I could have done some horrible things. Luckily, we didn't. A lot of lessons learned and a lot of opportunities learned. But please work at peoplenow.org. It's got I've got cards. I want a few cards, but they're from me. But thank you very much. The same thing about this, the health. The idea of getting people working together on this health is really important. Really important to share that. And my website shows where the money will come from. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Comments, questions? Yes, please.
You're talking about how pharmaceutical companies don't encourage sending cures for epidemics. How can we incentivize different pharmaceutical companies to tackle things like Ebola?
Well, I mean, there are, when I say radical, there are very big ideas out there, like the Health Impact Fund. But there are also things that we're already starting to do, which are probably more likely, which are public-private partnerships, to put some public money in, along with funds that pharmaceutical companies do, and also to perhaps give market commitments, pre-commitments to buying these drugs. I mean, I think the problem with epidemics are that they're too unpredictable. So if you look at a pharmaceutical company and you ask, well, why do they invest in seasonal vaccine for flu but not in pandemic vaccine? The answer is that seasonal is predictable. There's a certain market, and it's profitable. But that's not true for pandemic because, you know, when a pandemic comes, it'll be catastrophic. But we don't know when it will come. We don't know what vaccine it will be. We don't even know what virus it will be, other than being, you know, a flu virus. We don't know whether, you know, what the particular strain of that virus will be. So you do. So public-private partnerships seem to be the way that we're moving.
Yes, please.
My name is Mari Shota, I'm working on education, working at the World Bank. I'm working on education, not health, so my question is related to health. So my question is very basic, but I have a question to Professor Akashi. I really like the concept of the Bosch Paper, the handbook. So what kind of challenges do you expect when we introduce that handbook for refugees and migrants? That is my question.
Thank you very much. I think that there is a several challenges. The first is that the confidentiality about the especially about the personal information. And then now I didn't present here, but we have to consider how the what kind of body will manage the data. For instance, the, some refugees, they don't want to put the personal information in the like database because they are afraid of some kind of political pressure or some risks. So the who will manage is still unclear. Maybe the, I think that the, some people said the UN itself is not sometimes unreliable. So the some kind of the like alliance maybe can be set up. So that is one of the challenges. So the I think that the other like a financial one also the. Who will pay for services, not only services, but also the, for the booklet, for instance. So there are several difficulties or challenges, but I think if I presented this idea to different organizations, they said, ah, it's good. But and one technician said, technically possible, but politically, difficult, he said. So, such kind of, I can say, like something predicted, predictable, but I think that some others unpredictable things can be happening.
So, no country, no region have introduced?
Now on the process, the we visited some organization, UN organization headquarters. They said, at first, please try in the field. And then if good result, they can take. So the, now, therefore, the, we are thinking in Jordan, one of the place to make a pilot. Because they have ANWA, not only ANWA, but also the UNHCR or IOM or other organizations are working there. And then according to our understanding, some organizations are interested in to work with.
Not for the refugees, but I think JICA had this, this handbook project in Indonesia and some other association handbooks.
Yeah, but the ANWA is that in Jordan, they already introduced an e-based electronic-based handbook, MCH handbook. Mm-hmm. So, like, there is a base.
Okay.
And then, the, sorry, additionally, that handbook, the name is Refugee Health Handbook, but some educational information or some qualification or work experience can be included.
I can talk all day. No,
I like other people to talk, so please, please hold it. Yeah, so I like other people to talk. Yeah.
I don't want to let it die.
Okay, so if maybe some of you may want to, you know, talk personally to some of the presenters, so I think I would like to close the session now, and we have 5 minutes for you to talk to
la presentación de Virginia de Comentetas. So thank you very much for participating in this session, and I think the discussion has been very fruitful, and I'd like to thank the two professors from Washington, D.C., to share the comments and feedback with us. And if you have some comments, maybe no. Okay, so thank you very much. And I think we should continue on this dialogue. And please come to Osaka in 2019. Okay, thank you very much.